Assalamu alaikum. Will they sing a song, African style song? Ghana style song? Are you ready? Come on, come here in front. Don't hide yourself behind this. Please. You can sit here. Come here, little one here. Hello, hello, hello. Come on. This way, please. And show them as well. Huh? Adjust your focus so that, yes. And these little children should also be within the frame. Bring them in. They're not yet. Yes? Okay. Much better now. Huh? How are you?
Fine.
Fine. What's your name?
Zainab.
Zainab. Beautiful name. And your name?
Fatima.
Fatima? Good. And you say in Africa, you say Fatimata. Don't you? Huh?
Yeah.
Not Fatima, but Fatimata.
Yes.
And who are you, little one?
Imran.
Imran. MashaAllah. That's a Pakistani style name. Okay. And how are you? Fine? Good, good. So we are here with the Ghanaian group or the African group? Ghanaian.
African group.
Other than Ghanaians as well?
More Ghanaians, actually Ghanaians.
Huh. But who are the other ones? Yeah. Which ones?
Marcellion? All of them are actually, not for this one, all Ghanaians.
So it's Ghanaian group?
Ghanaian group. That's Ghanaian group.
Yeah, it's not a wider African group, yes, quite right. When we have a bigger studio ready, inshallah, which is being prepared, then we'll have a larger meeting with all Africans.
All Africans.
Okay. So today, we have this special program of insectivore variety program, in which I'll give you opportunity to ask any questions if you like, to tell us something about Ghana and the Ahmadiyya there, how it began and when it came, and the quality of the dedication and spirit of Ahmadi Muslims in Ghana. And also, you can ask any questions you like, pertaining to Ghana particularly. And then these children would sing us a beautiful song, I hope, inshallah. Huh? And then you can also demonstrate your Ghana style, Allahu Akbar and La ilaha illallah, Muhammadur Rasulullah. Okay? So this is the general plan of things. Okay? No rehearsals, just straight away. Okay? Come on then.
Okay.
What would you like? No, I'll tell you when to sing. But to begin with, I would like you to start. You are the president of the Ghanaian Muslim Society in England. How many members do you have here from Ghana?
From Ghana, in fact, the Pan-African Ahmadiyya Muslim Association was inaugurated for us by Hazrat Al-Fatu Masih himself in 1987.
That's right.
Members are very active. The predominant group of members come from Ghana,
yes,
then Nigeria,
mm-hmm,
then Sierra Leone,
right,
a few from Zambia
and the Gambia,
what? And then Kenya,
right,
and Tanzania.
Right.
We meet once every month here in the London Mosque. Mm. And our program is designed
to... you have a wider forum comprising all the Africans who are living in England.
We
have a meeting together, haven't we?
We have a meeting.
Yes.
When we organize our dinner reception particularly, we are always short of space in Mahmoud Hall.
Right,
people,
yes,
attend in their large numbers.
Yes.
We are very active in Tabligh work. Right. And then our image is... coming up that when visitors come to London Mosque, they do ask of our officers,
mm-hmm,
that where are the...
But you have forgotten to introduce yourself.
Thank you very much, Huzoor.
Yes.
My name actually is Ismail B.K. Addo. I was Ghana's former ambassador to Ethiopia. I'm now resident here in London.
Right.
Ismail B.K. Addo.
There's another ambassador who was posted in Germany last time, before his resignation. What was his name?
He was Ambassador Yaqub.
Yaqub, that's
Yaqub,
right.
Yeah.
Where is he
was. He is here in London, I don't see him quite often these days. He was he was in Germany.
That's right.
But here,
you better tell him to come and meet me one day.
Yes, I will. I know he lives somewhere around the Putney. I'll get a pass on the message to him.
Okay. Now begin with where you left, please.
So the Pan-African Ahmadiyya Muslim Association is what I was commenting on, and we are very active, and we do get in touch with students in universities and visitors.
And you belong to Kumasi, don't you?
Yeah, I do. I come from
there. We have a large concentration of Ahmadiyya.
From Kumasi in Ashanti. Yeah, very.
It is Ashanti region.
Ashanti region.
That's right.
Yeah.
And where does Ashanti Hine live, where we went to meet?
Yeah, I did say yes. Ashanti lives at Manshia, part of Kumasi, a very big palace called Manshia. Manshia means the meeting place of all the people.
He's Manshia. The biggest chief in Ghana, isn't he?
The biggest.
I think the foreign visitors, like kings and queens and other dignitaries, who visit Ghana, they always call on him as well.
They call on him as a matter of courtesy.
That's right.
And then depend upon the status of the visitor. It's always arranged, in fact, even at governmental level,
right,
that if they enter Ashanti, then they are of necessity to call on Otunfo, the Ashanti.
I remember having met him. It was a very interesting meeting with him.
That was, he also cherished memories of that.
He does. You know, something very interesting happened. When I went to see him, I found it very, very stiff formalities all everywhere. Mm-hmm. All the big chiefs were barefoot, and none of them dared put his shoes on in the presence of Ashanti Hine. Mm-hmm. He was held in such respect and awe by all. And then it was, I was told it was customary for me not to address him directly, but I would address Imam Sahib, who was with me, Abdul Wahab Adam. He would speak to his representative, who would translate what he said to him on my behalf. He would speak to one counterpart on the other side, standing face to
face. The chief linguist.
And
the
then,
chief
linguist. Then he would translate it into, the message was conveyed to him, then he would translate it into local language. And then that man would bend down and speak into the ear of the chief. And then he will answer something. And then it will pass around exactly like the same way, you know. After a minute or two, you know, I felt very uneasy about it. Addressing him directly, I said, look here, you are an Oxford graduate or a highly educated person somewhere.
He studied law in this country.
And you know English so well, why should we speak together, face to face, one another, to each other, and forget about all the formalities? That brought the first smile I saw on his face. Broad smile, and he beamed with smiles. Oh yes, why not? And they chucked away all the formalities, and it was then a very friendly talk. And then we had a very good embrace, and all this is recorded in the picture. Then he asked me to sign the book, which he said, I have got the new book now. I want your initial to be the first on it.
Alhamdulillah, that was very good.
And then I signed the book. And ever since, you know, I have been cherishing his memory. He's a very fine man. I hope he's still Ashanti Hine.
Yeah, he's still Ashanti Hine. He's still Ashanti Hine.
So if you kindly convey my regards to him and love to him and tell him, he's been mentioned on this international television, Muslim television, Ahmadiyya. He would be happy to.
He did pass through London on his way to America last year.
I see.
So I will try to find out. Anytime he's in London, I will make a request.
You convey the message. I would love to meet him here, and I would love him to be my guest, if possible.
I will convey this message. Okay. This is delightful, very. Yeah. And before that, this message will go to Ghana.
Now, if any questions, are there any questions you would like to ask?
Yeah.
Or even the little ones, if you'd like to ask a question.
Yes, please, Huzoor. Could I start? Now that Ghana has been mentioned as part of Huzoor's tour of Africa, 6-7 years ago, Huzoor did tour about 10 African countries. Do you still cherish memories of those countries?
Yes, yes, of course.
Those countries.
Of course, I do.
And
very much love the countries and the peoples of those countries I visited. And I'm in constant touch with people from all walks of life, all levels.
Was the tour pleasant for Huzoor in all those 10 countries, or was it only in Ghana? Or
No, everywhere.
Everywhere, in all those countries.
Absolutely. Some of the heads of the states are no more holding the same office now, and some revolutions took place, etc. But it has not changed a bit our relationship with the people and the officials and the governments of those countries. Whoever comes and goes, and it stays.
That's very good.
Yes.
And we've been seeing pictures of some of the, when at the exhibition we had a centenary, we saw the pictures mounted for those stuff.
That's right. Yes.
Yeah, very nice.
So, shall we begin with an informal chat? Incidentally, this program was called previously Batcheet, and some people suggested other names. And then I invited suggestions from all over the world, and my pile containing those suggestions has grown up to this size. Very interesting names were suggested. Everybody had his go at it. But finally, I think it's simple and plain, and one single word, Mulaqaat, will do. Because Mulaqaat is traditionally institutionalized in the Jamaat, and all the Mulaqaats of Caliphs were called Mulaqaat. So in Mulaqaat you have a sense of, you know, sitting one before the other and speaking to each other. So it's practically the same. So I think from now on we'll refer to this Batcheet program as Mulaqaat. Batcheet means a casual talk. So it was how it began. But now it has become more than a casual talk. So I think Mulaqaat is much better.
Yes.
Okay?
Yes.
In future we'll refer to this meeting as Mulaqaat. So I'm having Mulaqaat with you and through you with Africa and with all the countries of the world.
So we can say that we did have Mulaqaat with Huzoor.
That's right.
On Saturday.
That's right.
Saturday.
Now bring this sweet peat. Before we proceed further, I want to tell you that with the grace of Allah we have a good news today. I will not disclose that news just now. But when time comes, when Allah so wills, that news will be shared by me with the rest of the world. But the good news there is, and I have got some sweetmeat to celebrate this.
So we should
please
help. Thank you very much. Please. Everybody,
everybody,
the right hand, take one.
Not the whole of the plate, please. Oh, yes. 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 Oh, yes, yes. Anything you like. You like Ulla or
Fatima, you also take
one. Fatima, please. That's right. Good. Please. And Munir Sahib, come on. Just five brothers, and let them come here and be in the picture as well. Come, say the Swal Sahib. And this is your son, who always helps you.
It is so sweet.
You don't like it?
I do, very much indeed. I will have a second.
Okay. Okay, yes.
A second bite and a cherry.
Okay. The second helping first for children and then for whatever is left over.
No.
Please?
Do that one.
Have some more. Have some more. That's right. Have some more. You? No?
Problem.
Please?
One more.
Yes.
Finish it, I think.
Good. So
nice.
Okay.
So nice.
Now, normally, my experience with the Africans is that they are not sweet-toothed people. They like salt, chilies,
yes. Mm-hmm.
But do not much
sugar.
Like sugar much, or you know, sweets. So that is why in their official dinners, sometimes sweet was not served at all. Instead, some fruits, of course, they go with the food, but not sweets like we have, or like the Europeans generally have as well.
Well, here at Lendemos, whenever we have our dinner and they serve the yellow rice as dessert.
They after like that, don't they?
They like very much indeed. Right. Everybody goes for a second plate.
We call it zarda.
Zarda.
That's right.
That's very good. Mm-hmm. With some nuts in it.
And, that's right, yes.
And
spices. And spices.
Not in that zarda. That is different. That is pulao.
The yellow sweet rice.
Yes, that is called zarda.
Yes.
So I think you haven't had so far an occasion to taste that yellow thing, have you?
I think I had it, and the other time
you mixed it with chilies or something.
Yes,
that's you did.
The first time I had it, I didn't know it was sweet.
That's
so I took a handful, and then I put some sauce on it,
and some curry and things.
Curry on it, and some spinach. That's funny. So one of the gentlemen beside me said, "No, this is dessert. So you should have told me, you know."
Right.
But actually, it's really nice. I like it. I did like it.
Underneath the chilies and everything, still it was quite okay. So next to the questions, please. Any child or anybody you would like to start?
Yeah.
Huzoor, yes. I believe in the existence of an almighty God who is righteous and who governs the righteous on the earth. In the recent times, and indeed since time immemorial, atrocities of various kinds have been committed against clearly innocent people, including children, and I have the cases of Bosnia and Pakistan in mind. How is this phenomenon explained by reference to the role of the Almighty on earth?
That's right. You see, where God Almighty has provided you with the option of following the path of goodness or following the path of evil, if you follow the path of evil, who's responsible? If you offer a choice to the students, sitting in the examination or before that, to study or not to study, but appear in the examination at last. If they fail, it is the examiner who declares them failed. Who has committed the atrocity against that boy who has been declared failed by the examiner? Is it the examiner or
the boy himself?
See? So you can't have another option. Either there has to be a choice or no choice. Where there is no choice, there are angels. They do not commit any atrocities, do they?
No.
Have you ever heard of an angel committing an atrocity?
No.
Because they have no choice.
No.
So if the choice is a risk and the outcome of this exercise depends on the people who make their choices. So it is a lesson for mankind that if you do not follow the instruction and injunctions of, let's say, the Quran or other revealed books, then the responsibility will be yours. It will be you who will be doing injustice to yourselves, committing atrocities against man. So man remains responsible, and these occasional outbursts of cruelties and atrocities are in fact the points where we can monitor what has man led himself to. it is the exposure point that all the atrocities which have been, you know, man has been nurturing within himself, they are given an exposure for the rest of the world to see. Oh man, it is there that you stand. This is what you have achieved. So God is never cruel to his creatures. It is the creatures themselves who sometimes, unfortunately, choose to be cruel to themselves. And this is the repeated message of the Holy Quran, again and again. It's up to you to follow a path of peace or not to follow a path of peace, to follow the path of absolute justice or to reject that path of absolute justice. If you do that, then you're in for big trouble. And these are the troubles which you begin to see now. These crimes are piled up, and they continue to pile up, with the result that when those nations which are oppressed, when they are given a chance to rule and to decide, then they show their true feathers. And then one begins to see they were also potentially cruel people. They were also potentially unjust people. Now, turn to Africa. Who is ruling Africa nowadays?
Nobody.
Africans. Supposed to. Supposed to rule.
It's a fact.
And who is committing atrocities against Africans?
Themselves.
See, this is it. Previously, you to throw all the blame on the whites.
The whites.
And the now they have gone, they have withdrawn. And it is again, you know, the basic inner, you know, distorted image of the people which was undercover previously. It has been exposed, it has come to be displayed, and then you know that it is morality which always counts. Without morality, freedom does not mean anything. Without morality, you can never be emancipated from the evils of this world. So this is a world of trial for us. And whenever we are put to trial, we see ourselves having utterly failed. So it's not a question of God being beneficent or not. It's a question of God having to make a choice of giving you a choice or not. When he gave you a choice, then those of you who stood that trial and came out of it with honor, with heads high, held high, then the type of people which are produced, the type of people mentioned in the Quran, Muhammadur Rasulullah, Walladina Mahu, you know, that's the beautiful outcome of this choice. Once you make the choice in the right direction, then the angels are left behind, then the Holy Prophet rises above all. Being a man, he does so. So this is the scheme of things. Without understanding this, you cannot resolve these small issues of Bosnia or atrocities being committed elsewhere. Right?
Yes, yes, thank you very much.
Next, please.
Huzoor, if I may be very straight to my point.
Please do. Like him, he was. Yes.
Is there a God?
Yes.
And if there is, what is the proof in special relationship to your own experience?
Well, I have seen God listen to my prayers so often, and many times, even before they rose from my heart, they took the shape of words. I have seen God listening to me and my desires and this and that, and taking care of the Jamaat. And despite the fact that Jamaat is so weak, and the enemies against the Jamaat are so immensely powerful, they could really practically crush us under their feet. But the outcome of every hostility against Ahmadiyyat, what does it do to us? It makes us bigger, stronger, wealthier, more honorable, more widely spread. So if there were no God behind us, how could this happen? Just now, I have given you the proof of this sweetmeat. There was something which I prayed for during the Ramadan in the last days, very earnestly. I said, no, God, enough is enough. I don't want to see another year. And there you are. I have heard this news today.
It's very delightful.
It's brilliant. Even though we don't know what it is.
But we know.
The whole Jamaat that will be sharing that the images later.
Alhamdulillah.
But you're the first to hear it from me, you know.
Inshallah, Allah, 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 Allah,
Inshallah.
If Lagna would progress, it's through the divine grace that it will progress.
Right. Okay, please. Come on,
your sister. Inshallah, Utala.
Inshallah, Utala. Inshallah, Utala.
Lagna Benyan Kosuo. Inshallah, Utala.
Inshallah, Utala. Inshallah, Utala.
Asala Benyan Kosuo Pala. Inshallah, Utala.
Inshallah, Utala. Inshallah, Utala.
Benyan Kosuo Pala. Inshallah, Utala.
Inshallah, Utala. Inshallah, Utala. Inshallah, Utala.
Afao Benyan Kosuo Pala. Inshallah, Utala.
Inshallah, Utala. Inshallah, Utala.
Zawo Hakwa Shifom Kum. Inshallah, Utala.
Inshallah, Utala. Inshallah, Utala.
Ahmadiyya Benyan Kosuo Pala. Inshallah, Utala.
Inshallah, Utala. Inshallah, Utala.
Hizu Benya Kantiti. Inshallah, Utala.
Inshallah, Utala.
Inshallah, Utala. Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa ala ali Muhammad wa barik wa salim.
Good.
Bismillahirrahmanirrahim. 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 Alhamdulillah, Rabbil Alameen.
Bismillahirrahmanirrahim. 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 Alhamdulillah, Rabbil Alameen.
Yeshasya ya dunya minitin. Yeshasya ya dunya minitin. Yeshasya ya dunya minitin. Nabiye ye fatana se bismillah.
Bismillahirrahmanirrahim. Bismillahirrahmanirrahim.
Bismillahirrahmanirrahim.
Alhamdulillah, Rabbil Alameen. Bismillahirrahmanirrahim.
Salli ala Nabiyyina Salli ala Muhammadin. Okay.
Salli ala Nabiyyina Salli ala Muhammadin
It could be some kind of
Have you finished your question? No. Was something
so
I
wanted
to check in? Imran, you want to sing again? Right, we come to that.
Okay.
Right. Assalamu alaikum. Huzoor, my question is, Islam means peace.
Yes.
And in most Islamic countries, we see the opposite. Can you reflect on that, please?
Do you see Islam practiced in those countries?
Well, I can't give you a definite answer.
But you have given me the answer already. Where there is no peace, there is no Islam. Already? Yes, that's right.
I'm not going to just have the answer. The question answers itself.
Yes, yes.
Where there is no peace, there is
no Islam.
No Islam.
Wherever there is Islam, there is peace. Peace of mind, peace of heart, peace of the society. All are the fruits of Islam. So when you see a tree not bearing a fruit, then you must reconsider what the nature of that tree be. Jesus Christ, in one of his profound wisdom, once said, sometimes he spoke in short phrases, short observations, but those are so full of wisdom that they become everlasting. One of these phrases is, the tree will be recognized by the fruit it bears. So if there is no fruit, there must be something wrong with the so-called tree. If it were without disease, if it were healthy, then it should bear the fruit it is created to bear. Right?
Thank you. Please, Huzoor, since you are Huzoor's inaugural address,
yes.
There has
which inaugural address? So many inaugural addresses.
Huzoor was inaugurated as the fourth Khalifa. The address that was made at
the very first
mosque,
one.
The very first one.
First
yeah, yeah, indeed. The mosque, yeah. We've been reflecting on that one.
Yes.
And ever since then, Huzoor's sermons and addresses all over the world,
right.
There has been this emphasis on Da Ilala.
That's right.
I know that other Khalifas were doing that also. But in Huzoor's case, the emphasis seems to be always on this Da Ilala. Is it for a special reason or something has happened? Because
I think, yes, it is for a special reason, but the special reason is that God knew that he was going to blow the wind in favor of Ahmadiyya. And for that, he himself instilled a deep desire in my heart to get totally dedicated to this cause. And I was, right from the word go, preparing the Jamaat for this task, which I know was destined because of the prayers of Hazrat Muhammad Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. The changes which we are beginning to appear, we see appearing in the world, are the changes which were destined from that time. It is the prayers of Hazrat Muhammad Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam which were being answered when Imam Mahdi was raised. And this is the right moment, right time. In God's calculations and God's mathematics, for the world now to be attracted very powerfully and irresistibly to the message of Islam. So that is why he made me, you know, almost mad after this. Right from the start, you know, I was totally dedicated to this. I kept on speaking to the Jamaat and knowing that something is going to happen. I remember in some of my earlier addresses, the very first year, I told the Jamaat that I can see the people, the armies marching into Islam. I can hear their footsteps. Why don't you get ready yourself for this, for deceiving them with open arms? So this was something which was to happen. No credit goes to me. Only Allah, I'm grateful to Allah for choosing me for this very special moment.
Nare!
Allahu Akbar.
Nare takbir.
Allahu Akbar.
Akbar.
Hazrat Ali Fadru Mumini.
Oli Ninja.
Hazrat Ali Fadru Mumini.
Oli Ninja. Hazrat Ali Fadru Mumini. Oli Ninja.
Allahu Akbar.
Oh, yes.
Nare Takbir.
Allahu Akbar.
This is very delightful. Huzoor, we've heard this thing I was here at the London Mosque when so many Nigerian Muslims came to make their bayat. It was that day was so spectacular, and I couldn't believe my eyes. I see so many people
in the hall,
in Mahmood Hall.
About 100 people.
One day, that was just very so impressive. Spectacular, very impressive. Yeah. We've been doing this Tabligh work. But is the UK soil not fertile for Tabligh work, or this? We've been having some difficulty here in the UK.
I think the fault does not lie with the soil, but with the cultivators. I'm sorry to say that.
The soil is fertile.
Properly.
We've got to. So they have to think of the seeds we put in. And they, That's very interesting.
Okay.
Yes.
Yes, yes.
I have another question for Huzoor. There has been a recent development in the Christian Church, specifically the Church of England, and that has been the recent ordination of a woman priest. What does Islam say as far as such a development is concerned? And
you see, we do not have in Islam institutionalized priesthood, ordained priesthood, as it's called in Christian terms. So it's irrelevant to us what they do, but what is relevant to us is that they are making their beliefs themselves now. It's not a question of interpretation of the Bible. They're making their own rules, own regulations, own code of life. So Christianity is in the hand of men now, human beings, persons, male and female. But it's no longer the old New Testament or Old Testament they refer to. That teaching is buried in the past, practically. Of course there are some living Christians, very few. The society which you see as Christian society is not Christian, because there are no Christian values. It is not Christian. It is fortunate and unfortunate. Fortunate for Christianity that this society is not Christian. Unfortunate for the society that it is not Christian.
The second leg of my question would have been to the effect that that's Islam. Was there the possibility of Islam getting women missionaries? But you anticipated my question.
And haven't you seen women missionary everywhere in the world now? Ahmadi ladies are moving forward, marching forward, shoulder to shoulder with men in preaching. And in many a country, you know, the ladies are producing such wonderful results and fruits. In Ghana, of course, you remember, before this new change in Ghana, before Ghana really woke up like lions and started preaching right and left and gaining fruits from
Nare
Takbir.
You see, until that happened, a few years before, it was all silent and dormant. I was deeply pained to watch this apathy towards preaching in Ghana. While Ghanaian people seem to be so full of zeal and dedication and everything, that which they lacked was preaching. So one day I remember a delegation which was visiting me during the Jalsa Salana from Ghana. I addressed the daughter of the Amir Sahib, Abdul Wahab, and said, what the men have not been able to do, I want now ladies of Ghana to do. Get up and take the cudgel in your hands. Fight for Islam. Men will follow suit. Once, you know, they're awakened and they're put to shame by ladies. And something of that nature did happen in Ghana. Now men are marching forward and ladies are lagging behind, but following suit.
Please, Huzoor, there is, I know other institutions provide social services.
Right.
But Jamaat Ahmadiyya seems to me have been providing too much of it without counting the cost and then looking at the benefits that will come, just providing, helping people in need and so on. Why is it? Because if you look at other organizations, they have an ulterior motive.
The fact is that these two things are not tied in the Quran with preaching or with any ulterior motives. The Holy Quran speaks of philanthropist works as totally divorced from any ulterior motives or regards for yourself, any gains which you have in mind. Otherwise, the words will not be philanthropic. So when you do something for the sake of Allah, do it entirely for the sake of Allah. Even those, imagine, even those who, you know, spoke the filthiest lies against Hazrat Aisha Siddiqa رضي الله تعالى عنها. When we know Hazrat Abu Bakr stopped paying, you know, by way of help, he was paying something, he was contributing towards some particular person needs, and it was his own daughter as well. But I have a feeling that it was not for the sake of her, his daughter, but it was for the sake of the Holy Prophet's wife. He got so much annoyed and disgusted that he closed his hand and said, "No more from me to you." You know, Allah revealed to the Holy Prophet, it's a verse in the Holy Quran, that those who did it for the sake of goodness itself, Allah does not want to stop them doing so, whoever it is. So from that, I have got my cue. I draw my last lesson from the Quran, not only from this, but so many other verses. So I have told the Jamaat to serve the cause regardless of what they are, who they are, which country they belong to. Wherever we can serve the cause of humanity, we must not serve the cause of humanity, we must serve the cause of Allah, to please Him. And if we do that, then Allah will please us. He will see to it that we will reward it, you know, when we do not expect any reward from people. So that is the emphasis. Serve the cause of humanity irrespective of their religion, creed, country, nationality, etc., etc. And do it for the sake of Allah. Look up to Him. And then He will take care of you. And that's what He's doing. Exactly, that is what He's doing.
Before I can please, there was this thing, when the Nusrat Jahan scheme was inaugurated and schools and hospitals were being opened here, particularly Ghana. Then I was in Ghana. And
which year are you talking about?
Talking about Huzoor from about 1975 to about 80.
That's right.
I used to be the secretary of the Jamaat in Ashanti.
Right.
And so requests came from various chiefs and organizations for schools to be opened in their communities and hospitals. I thought that, oh, here is an opportunity for the Jamaat maybe to make money. Because if you open a hospital, money should be flowing. But then later on I heard that all monies from hospitals and so on were to be spent in those countries.
The same, their own cause.
For their own cause. That's a question I didn't understand very well.
Now you have understood.
Now I've understood with this.
Alhamdulillah.
Now I've understood.
And they tell me that there's only 1 minute left. So let's say goodbye to each other. Say assalamu alaikum.
Assalamu alaikum.
Allah bless you. as we call it in Urdu, Khuda Hafiz, Fi Amanillah in Arabic, and in the Bosnian language, Allah Imanat. In the trust of Allah. Okay? So meet you again, inshallah. It was a very interesting program. Allah bless you all. Assalamu alaikum. Assalamu alaikum, children. Thank you for the beautiful song. Khuda Hafiz. Assalamu alaikum.